the director of McCanick, Josh C. Wallen. Yeah, we only have 15 minutes, so we might miss out on the questions.
I want to call a couple people up, if everyone doesn't mind. I would like to call David Morse. Woo! Miro Hines. Daniel Noah. And Martin Albright. So the people I'm calling up, you obviously know who David and Kieran are. We have our writer and our cinematographer coming out, who I think deserve a little bit of recognition.
Welcome everyone and congratulations. As everyone's getting assembled, I'll just open the questions up by asking why you wanted to tell this particular story. What inspired you to tell this story?
It all starts with the script that Daniel wrote. He wrote it almost 20 years ago, just as like a spec script. We were roommates in 97, 98, and I had read it back then, and it just resonated with me. And something about like the character of Eugene McCanick, I couldn't shake him. He just felt like someone whose story deserved to be told, and just happened to take us a couple decades to tell it. So yeah.
Thank you very much. That's a long time to come to fruition. You must feel pretty awesome that we're watching it tonight.
Pretty good.
Good. Awesome. I'll open up the floor if anyone else has a question. It's a little bright up at the back, so if you have a question up at the back. Oh, people are pointing, so yes, please.
What's the motive for McKinney chasing a science character?
Okay, so the questions are about the motive. McCanick chasing character.
That is a big question. I'm gonna hand it off.
Well, I'm curious what David has to say, but we spoke a lot about this, and I think we always felt like there were a lot of different reasons why McCanick wanted to speak to Simon. And I don't know, in my mind, I don't know if McCanick even really knew what he would do when he caught up with him. I personally believe McCanick stated, "I just wanted to talk." That's my take on it. And I think that he, this is a movie, of course it is about what it's like to be of a certain generation and to have had a homosexual experience, and to feel that that's not something that anyone can know about. But more generally, it's about what it is to be a man and how men are not supposed to expose any vulnerability. I think it's getting better. But for men of McCanick's generation, the idea of,
yeah. You know what I'd like to say? I'd like to say, we're crying. Thank you. Thank you to all of you for staying here. And talking to us about this, but also just want to say how proud I am of Cory. You know, he was very smart to do this role. Most of us knew him from Glee, and I don't think any of us knew him from this. And I think he was just great. So. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll come out again. Yes, right here.
I have a question for David. It has to do with how you modeled your police characters. We heard one character say, this is the French Connection, you know. And I just wonder, when you're preparing for this role, which other films, which other police characters might you have
Thank you. So if I'm hearing your question, it's how did you model the character of a police officer, and did you use any particular police characters from film or references of officers in preparing the role?
Yeah, that was great.
Yeah, absolutely.
How you play a police officer.
Yeah.
Great. Thank you.
Yeah, well, I think the first thing I would say is that, and this has to go with the question back there as well, I think what Daniel gave us was a police character that is sort of familiar to us for a lot of this film. A police officer who's kind of gone off the grid a little bit, is working outside of what we would consider acceptable, obviously. And the thing that I was most interested in and most concerned about is that thing that was hidden for most of his life and really trampled on for most of his life. And something that he couldn't even define for most of his life and probably didn't even know what it was until he was in that room in this scene here, began to experience it and open up to it. And it was hard to model that on anything else. That was just purely taking what these guys had come up with and given ourselves over to it, which is what Cory did so beautifully. You know, I had to be the recipient of him. And I know I was nervous about the scene, and I'm sure he was too. And I thought he handled it gracefully and just beautifully. So to answer your question, the cop felt familiar in some ways. And obviously there's work, you know, talking to the cops and all that, so we can really believe what we're doing out there. But the other part of it is just that finding a place in here that I haven't been before.
Thank you. I'm going to go out again. And yes, way up in the back.
Well, the quick answer is that Daniel had, you know, woven flashbacks into the script. All of the initial flashbacks are the way that they were, you know, when we read it. We had to make some adjustments to the end of the film, even before we began production, which we made some adjustments to the script as well, and just for budgetary reasons. That meant cutting up the chase sequence at the end and using the flashbacks to cut that up. So, like, you know, we didn't have the money to shoot a chase sequence for 2 weeks. We had 2 days to shoot that chase. And so a way to, you know, to chop that chase up and make it seem bigger than it actually was by using the flashbacks. But on an emotional level, you know, the kind of the climax, the emotional climax of film in a way is you know, the kiss, you know. So you want to sustain that until, you know, to show it to the very last moment, and you know, chopping it up like that really, really helped it, I think, punctuate some of the moments. And I wanted to try to, you know, find a seamless way to insert those throughout the film where it wasn't like, you know, just in your face flashbacks. I'm not a fan of flashbacks, even though I use lots of them. So.
Thanks for your question. Yes, right here.
This story, Daniel, is it personal? Is it, where did it come from, and why did you feel the need to write it?
So Daniel, where did the story come from, and why did you feel the need to write it?
I knew someone would ask that, and I don't have a good answer. You know, all I can say is I've always had gay people in my life and gay people in my family, and it's I've been very close to the incredible agony of not being able to be who you truly are, not being able to love as you truly love without feeling shame. I think Josh did an amazing job of not hitting that nail too hard on the head. The little reinforcements throughout the film that Eugene can't be who he really is. And enjoy your family, you know, little things like that reinforce to McCanick that he can't express himself. So it's just a real phenomenon, and it's horrible. And I think, you know, it starts in grade school. Kids calling each other fag and you know, saying that's gay, you know, it's not okay because there are kids on the playground who are gay, and they're being taught right from the beginning that they can't love openly, and it's horrible. And so I don't have a good clean answer. It's not based on anything specific except just compassion, I suppose.
That's a great answer, so thank you. opening it up again to you. Yes, way up there.
I was just wondering if you thought of a different ending for McCanick, because that last scene was showing so much compassion and understanding from a youth that was long all his life. Did you think of a different ending for him?
Was there ever a time when you thought of a different ending for McCanick? We all go to dating first.
Most attention any writer has ever had. Well, there were lots of different endings, and in fact, some of the story elements that are the ones we're most talking about now didn't even come in until maybe a decade into the Genesis of the script. But there were many, many, many different endings, and I think we all, you know, just as Josh said, that the climax of the film isn't a chase sequence; it's a kiss that. And this kind of circles back to the earlier question, what was motivating him to want to speak to Simon so badly, is that he could not believe that this boy had loved him after the things that he'd done. And he needed to confront that and to understand what it was. Corey's character in the present action is an extremely enlightened man who used his time in prison to find a peace and a forgiveness. I think that he forgave McCanick a long, long time ago and decided to turn this tragedy into something positive, trying to help gay youths on the street. Really the only ending that mattered was the emotional ending.
And the ending in terms of like McCanick's demise, I mean, his death was less to do about, you know, he wasn't killing himself because he's ashamed of anything. I think that, like, over the course of the film, and some of the stuff that he does is, you know, pretty horrible, you know, with Floyd and everything. I think, it sounds horrible, but like, I think the only place for McCanick to go is death at the end of this film. It felt like the right place for him to go. Just, you know, if he lived, we've seen that all before, and it just didn't make sense. You know, we toyed with that, but she didn't live, and it never worked.
Not that I want David to die.
No, and just one of the things about not having a lot of money to work with, originally that whole ending, you saw that place go in flames. You had the big explosions. And in some ways, probably emotionally, it was better that we don't get to see that, that we stop before that, because it really is about McCanick and whatever is happening within him. It's not about the explosions and the flames. So that was a different ending. Also, there was something else that happened, just that embrace in the end. That was not really there when we started shooting. And Daniel started thinking about that the final moments between Simon and McCanick, and he suggested an embrace, and I think Josh and I kind of went,
we just were like, I don't think that's so. Right.
And then I kept thinking about it as we got closer and closer to it, and all of a sudden it started, of course that's it. And I don't know what you felt, but for me, emotionally, and just story-wise, it felt absolutely right. I'm so glad I came up with that thought.
That moment, that embrace is just incredibly emotional. It's hard to watch for me, and just the way that you guys played it was touching.
Indeed. He saw a hand right there. No, yes, sorry. So Cory's role being so different than his role on Glee, and how did Cory become involved in the project?
I didn't see Cory in the role, to be honest. Cory and David share the same agent, and Sarah, their agent, said, I think that you should meet with Cory Monteith. And I was like, the Glee guy? And she was like, yeah. She went on and saying that he's really trying to expand what he's doing. He knew that Glee wasn't going to last forever. He wanted to get a jump on building his his career. And I just had something in my mind. I've been living with the project in my imagination for so long that I had a set vision of who Simon Weeks should be. And he should be kind of small and meek and And I took the meeting and I met with Cory, and he just, he had read the script three or four times, by the time we had our first meeting, and just started going on about the character. And I have to play. I mean, he was saying, I have to play this role. I have to play this. And he started going on about his past, when he was a teenager, and just saying, there's things that I have in my, he didn't say in my arsenal, but there's stuff that I've gone through where I can use that. I've never been able to utilize that as an artist. Over the course of that first meeting, I was just like, God, I think this guy's the guy. And I called David afterwards, and Dan was like, I think it's Cory Monteith. And I'm like, really? And then finally we just all signed on. And then once he came to Philly and we started shooting, the moment the cameras were rolling, all of us just went, oh, okay, we get it. And any vision we may have had about any other type of actor was gone. He was the character, so he won us over.
Thank you. And I have one more, yes.
Me?
Yeah.
First of all, congratulations, it's a terrific film.
Thank you.
Just have two short questions. One is, what was the budget, which you alluded to a couple of times, and do you have distribution for the film?
Wait, finance or producer, and they're like.
So the question is around the budget and distribution.
And I didn't hear the distribution. We have partial distribution in some territories worldwide. We don't have domestic, but that's what this festival's for. And the budget, it was under $1 million. That's all I'm going to give. So
good for you.
No, it wasn't a lot, and it would not be the movie that it was without a couple people over here. Martin, who shot this movie, just the way this movie looks, and I've done a few movies, I just think is just phenomenal, and you can't spend enough money to get what he did with this movie. Just putting the camera on his back and jumping into these scenes and sticking into people's faces. And it's so artistic and it's so brave, some of the things he did. When I was smashing that room apart, it was me and him in that room and Josh hiding behind his sofa. And he and Martin had things just flying past
him. Goggles on.
So it's just wonderful. And Kieran over here representing.
Thank you all for your questions and for sticking around. Thank you to the team.